Om Vamshi Vibhushita Karat Navanira Dabhati Damparat Aruna Bimba Bhalatharoshtat Purnentu Sundara Mukhat Aravinda Netrat Krishnat Param Kimabitattva Maham Najane Krishnat Param Kimabitattva Maham Najane. So we have seen these two paths to self-realization or God-realization, whichever way you choose to put it. So we also understood self-realization is a process of unfolding your hidden spiritual potentialities as you interact with the world. That is how we chose to understand spirituality or self-realization. So it is an ongoing experience. It is an ongoing timeless experience. It doesn't end in time. In fact, it lifts you bow beyond time. And all happy experiences are experiences where time ends. When you are happy, you don't feel time. When you are unhappy, you feel the weight of time. So time, which is the expression of thought. So thought and time are two sides of the same coin. And it is that which puts limitations on your spiritual identity. So once you realize who you are and come to abide there, you will be able to express that infinitude in a million and one ways as you interact with the world. So how do we reach that state? One path, one method is to reflect upon the great statements of the scriptures of the world. And when not only you reflect, first you listen, sravana, then you reflect, then guide your life, you guide your life according to those great statements. Lekta tumasi, that was the one word, sentence that we chose for special reflection, or aham brahmasmi, etc. So that was the path of jnana marga, the path of wisdom or path of knowledge. Continuous reflection upon this great statement. Listen, reflect and realize. And the second day we talked about karma yoga, which means non-reaction to the fruits of your works. Karma yoga does not mean you have no goals in life, you have no plan of action. You don't want to win, anything will be okay. That kind of a resigned mentality generally is going for karma yoga. But that is not the real meaning of karma yoga. You have definite goals, you are a focused person, you organize your energies, direct your energies for the realization of those goals. But you know that you have no absolute control over the realization of goals, and hence you are ready for any outcome. So that ability to accept any outcome without getting upset, accepting any outcome without getting upset is called karma yoga. So it is essentially an attitude towards the fruits of your works. And we have seen you cannot avoid work. Work is there. If you don't work, then you will be made to work by others. You will be asked to work. Or you will be used as a slave by others. They'll tell you, do this, do that, do something else. But at least you want some food. They'll give you some food, then they'll make you do all kind of work. So it is better that you choose what to do rather than somebody else chooses for you. If you don't choose, somebody else will choose for you. That is the definition of a slave, whose decisions are made by others. So to avoid that situation, you better be active in life. And then activity creates tension. And to avoid tension, one should avoid reaction to the outcome of work. This is what we saw elaborately yesterday. Today, we shall be discussing the path of devotion, the third day. The path of devotion, expanding one's heart, one's spiritual heart, expanding the circle of one's love, concern, readiness to share, expanding the area of your affection, that is called devotion. So as the one who introduced today's theme, he said that devotion is love for the higher. Emotion is love for your own little self. When your emotion is confined to the little self, that is called ordinary love. And when your emotion goes over the confines of your little self and is turned its attention towards the higher, that is called devotion. Love for the deity is devotion. Love for a particular object is called emotion. So when you love an object, you reduce the object. We reduce anything, even if a person, if you love him, you reduce him to the status of a thing, and you want to control him or her, put her in her place or him in his place, control, manipulate, give it a name. That's why when you love a person, you give that person many names, which his parent never gave, because that's the way manipulation. You're manipulating that person by giving him name, and you become possessive, and you expect that person to all your bidding, and if that person is not listening to what you say, then your love becomes anger. So first you wrote letters in blood to that person, and that person was bowled over by your affection. And against everybody's wishes and good counsel, that person married you, let us say. And after the second day or third day, matrimony becomes acrimony. And you start drawing her blood. First you wrote letters in blood, now you are ready to draw blood. Because in ordinary love, it comes from your own sense of inadequacy, your own sense of limitation. You don't want to get out of your little ego confines. And then you want to reduce the other person also to your status. You want to reduce him or her into a thing and manipulate. That creates a lot of heartburns later. So instead of that kind of a confined, limited, possessive, manipulative love, when you turn your attention to the higher, that's why sometimes devotion is called love for all. Love for God is love for all. It is a state of your awareness where you are in love with everything. Not only with the people, with the things, with the mountains, with the rivers, with the flowers, with the everything, you are in love. Because you experience that enormous energy welling up. Because the heart, which is capable of loving everything, that heart is opened, and the wellsprings of love is inspired, and thereafter you are in love with everything. So when you say I love God, it means I love everybody. Love for God is devotion. And in that love there is no possessiveness. You don't want to possess God. That's why when you love God, you want everybody to love God, isn't it? You want your God to be loved by everybody. That's why you become a proselytizing person. You go around tomtoing the glory of your God. And you say, my God did this, my God died for humanity, so follow him. So when you love God, you want the entire world to follow you in loving your God. But you love an ordinary person. Would you like everybody to love that person? You want to possess, you want to manipulate, you want to tie him or her down in a little room and want her or him to do all your biddings. So because that is possessive love. So love for God expands your heart, opens the wellsprings of your emotions, and you are in love with the whole world. And that's the true meaning of love or devotion. So whenever I use the word love here, please understand, I use that word in terms of devotion for the higher. So, and hence you cannot say, I love Krishna. Some people say, I love Krishna, Swami. I can die for Krishna. But I cannot stand the Krishna Swami. When I see Krishna Swami's face, my blood pressure goes up. But when I think of Krishna, I feel so good. You cannot say like that. If you love Krishna, you have to love everybody. Krishna says, Yo mam pasyadi sarvatra, sarvam chamayi pasyadi, tasyaham na pranasyami, sajame na pranasyadi. Whoever loves me has to love everybody. And whoever sees me everywhere, in everything, he alone really enjoys the true meaning of love. And hence, if you love Krishna, you have to love everybody. And because Krishna himself says, I live in everybody. Yomam pasyati sarvatra, whoever sees me everywhere. In the 11th chapter, Krishna reveals his Virat, Vishwarupa, an all-embracing form. He says, I am seeing through all eyes, I am walking through all legs, I am grabbing through all hands, I am hearing through all ears. So from that description of Krishna's nature, we realize to love Krishna means to love everybody. So that passion for all is devotion. Love for all is devotion. And hence, in the 12th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, it is said, Adveshta sarvabhudanam. That is the greatest definition of devotion. Sometimes I hear people saying, Swamiji, devotion is easy. Knowledge is very difficult. Karma yoga is much more difficult. Devotion, because I have to simply love the Lord. And fortunately, the Lord is not anywhere near. So therefore, he doesn't demand anything of me. I don't have to cook or prepare hot water for him, because he is not around. And whatever I give him, he gives me back. So it's easy to love God rather than loving my husband or my wife or my children or my mother-in-law, which is most difficult. And this is our idea of loving God. Krishna says, if you want to love me, you want even the least and the lowliest of people. You have to love him. Then alone, your love is true love. So the path of devotion is not that easy. In the 12th chapter, which deals with the bhakti, devotion, Krishna says, Adveshta sarvabhudanam. Love means not hating anybody. There's no hatredness in his heart. Because he sees the Lord enveloping the whole world. The whole world is seen as a form of the Lord. I'll be coming to that later. So, because you see the Lord everywhere, you cannot hate anybody. So, Adveshta sarvabhudanam. Maitra karunayava chan, you must be friendly towards everybody. Not only that, you don't dislike anybody, you are friendly towards everybody. And you are positive towards everybody. Maitra karunayava cha, compassionate towards all. And nirmamo nirahankara, free from ego and egoistic attachments. Nirmamo nirahankara, suga, dukkha, suga, chami, samachami. And this person is Shami, great patience, and he is same in pleasure and pain. So that is the definition of a devotee. And how do I gain that state? This is the question. It is very easy to say, but how do I gain that state? Now let me discuss a little more of what devotion is. There are, when I talk about devotion, three names comes to your mind if you are well-versed, steeped in Indian wisdom tradition. Three names will be coming to your mind when we talk of devotion. One is Narada. Narada was a great devotee. He was a great devotee of Lord Hari, and he spent all his life in propagating the glory of Hari. So Narada is one name which comes to your mind. Second is Hanuman, the great devotee. King Karaha, King Kim Nakarodi, he is ready to do anything for Lord Rama. You are so much in devotion to Lord Rama, you are ready to do anything. Nah, that is Hanumanji. And the third is Prahlad, another great devotee. Of course, there are many, many names that you may remember. But these are the three prominent names among devotees. So here, Narada has written a book on devotion called Narada Bhakti Sutra. Sutra statements on devotion by Narada. statement on devotion by Narada. In that, Narada defines devotion as sattvasmin parama prema rupa, he said. Devotion is supreme love, parama premam, unconditional love, non-demanding, unconditional love. In ordinary love, there is a demand. I give you something and you must give me something in return. But here, in love, in true love, that demand is not there. An opportunity to give itself is considered as a great favor. So it is unconditional, non-demanding love for the Supreme. The Supreme you have not seen. You don't know how he is or she is. Because in Indian wisdom tradition, the Supreme can be conceived as he or she or it also. Any pronoun will apply in the description of the Supreme. So devotion is unconditional, non-demanding love for that supreme power, whose glory, even an iota of that glory, you are not aware of. So it's a kind of activity of the mind, direction of the mind, which has no purpose. There's no motivation there. You are not getting anything out of it. It's out of your helplessness. You are in love, like a mother loves her baby. She doesn't expect anything from the baby, is it not? When the mother breastfeeds the baby, keeps the baby, nurses the baby, nourishes the baby, the mother does not think the baby will grow up and become the president of India, and then I'll be able to live in Rashtrapati Bhavan. The mother doesn't have such a selfish motive. Helplessly, she is in love. So Narada says, devotion is unconditional, non-demanding love for the Supreme. Not anything limited, but the Supreme. And in your understanding of the Supreme is, that Supreme is not just a transcendental entity. The Supreme is an all-encompassing entity. That's our idea, the Hindu or the Indian idea of Supreme. The Supreme is not just transcendental, beyond the mundane, but the Supreme encompasses everything. It is an all-encompassing transcendence. And towards that, you have supreme love. Love for truth, love for beauty, because Lord is the most beautiful. Love for truth, because Lord is the most truthful. And love for goodness, because Lord is the ultimate good. And your love for that is called devotion, according to Narada. And Narada says, when you are in a state of devotion, sattuna kamayamana, there is no desire, he says. In a state of devotion, when your heart is welling up with love for the higher, then there is no desire. It's a state you are totally free from desire. That's what I said. It's a non-demanding state of mind. There's no demand. You want to only give. You don't want to receive anything in back. You don't want any courtesy. When you are in love, that's whenever we are in love, if the person whom we love, even if he slaps, we accept it happily. So it is a non-demanding, satuna kamayamana. And then amrutasvarupacha, and you live in a zone where the time has no existence. It is a timeless experience for you when you are in love. You don't know how long you are in that condition, where you are, how you are, what you get. And you are ready even to humiliate yourself. That's why it is sattu bhalasvarupa amrutasvarupa cha. So these are some of the definition of love. And Narada says, how do you reach this state of love? How do you do that? He says, pick up an ideal. And pick up an ideal and then worship that ideal. He says, bhakti, according to Narada, puja disha anuraga. I'm just giving you some outlines. Puja disha anuraga. When you are in love, you start worshipping that object. Puja. You start worshipping, you give him the best, you offer him the best, you always have nice words about that person, and you always want to be with that person. So puja disha anuraga. Isn't it? When you go to a temple, what you do? You do puja. You wash the feet of the Lord. You offer him fruits, flowers, clothes, you do abharanas, all kind of jewelries you give to Lord. Whatever you have, you give to that Lord. So puja adishanuragaha is an expression of devotion. And another definition, according to Narada, is kathashravana adishanuragaha. Whomever you love, you want to hear the glories of that person. Very rarely it happens. Generally, you want to hear your own glories. But once you are in love, for example, a mother would love to hear the glory of her son. A lover will love to hear the glory of her beloved. A son would like to hear the glory of his mother, if he is in love, if he loves his mother. And if you are a patriotic person, you would love to hear the glory of your country, because you love your country. If the country may not be that glorious, but still you would love to hear, oh, this country in the past, such and such things happened. So you would like to hear the glory. So katha shravanadisu anuraga. When you love to hear the glory of anybody, that means you love, you respect, you are devoted to that person. If you love to give somebody the best that you have, that means you are in love with that person. Otherwise you won't give the best. You will give only the second best. Why should I give the best? I'll keep the best with me and the second best I will give. But if you are truly in love with a person, whenever you get the best thing, a good flower or a good fruit or a good piece of clothing, immediately you think of that person. Let me reserve it for him. Or a packet of chocolate. Whom do you think? The first thing. Either your son, young son, or your beloved, or somebody who you are deeply in love with, you will definitely remember that person. So according to Narada, puja adishanuragaha or kathashravana adishanuragaha, the interest in listening the glory of that person. And the third definition, according to Narada, bhakti is tadasmin tadarpit akhila acharada tad vismarane parama vyakulada, he said. All your actions are dedicated to that person. Whatever, whenever you do, you remember the object of your love all the time. That is a kind of drunken state. In that state, whatever you do, wherever you go, the thought of that person is always haunting you. You can never take out that thought from you. A mother who has a 2-year-old child, she goes to work, let us say. In the Western countries, even here in cities, you find leaving the 2-year-old baby, the mother goes to work. All the time she is thinking about the baby, isn't it? All the time. While she is driving to work, while she is working in the office, while she is driving back, all the time her heart is pounding hard, is beating faster, thinking about the child. Every time, whatever she does, the thought of the child goes like a shruti in a music program. Like a shruti, it goes all the time. So tadarpita akhila acharada tad vismarane paramavyakulada. And whenever you forget the name of that person or that object, then you feel great anxiety. So this is how Narada defines love, the great exponent of devotion. Now let me explain the idea of devotion propounded by one of the greatest devotees called Prahlada. Prahlada was a 7-year-old child who was in great love of God Hari, Lord Hari, and he has to fight with his father because father vied for Prahlada's attention with the God. Prahlada's father, Hiranyakashipu, thought Prahlada must love me rather than God. But Prahlada thought, I must love God. And my father comes next to God, not supreme. I came through my father, but God is my original father. With that idea, Prahlada developed great devotion for the Lord. And his father was very envious of this state. And we all get envious, because we want our children to be devoted to us, not to anything else, not to the country, not to an idea, not to a pursuit. because we are possessive in our love. So Prahlada's father wanted Prahlada to be devoted to him. So after, when he completed his education, when he came back, he asked, "What have you studied, child, in the college or in the school?" Prahlada said, "Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnoho, Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakyamatma Nivedanam." He said this, and his father got really angry. His father wants him to say Hiranyaya Nama, not Narayanaya. Om Namo Narayanaya, Om Namo Narayanaya. This is what Prahlada wanted to repeat. But whereas his father wanted him to say Hiranyaya Nama, gold is everything. Money speaks. That is what he wants to Prahlada to learn. That is why he sent him to the college. That is why he sent him to the management institute. When he comes back, he must be able to say, money speaks. Money is everything. Money is power. Whereas Prahlada said, God speaks. God is everything. And Hiranyakashipu couldn't take it any longer. And he started torturing Prahlada. And so let us understand, what is the idea of devotion according to Prahlada, the greatest devotee? And he represents the true ideal of devotion. So Prahlada says, devotion begins with Shravanam, listening about God. What is God? We have no idea of God. Any of you have an idea of God? We have different ideas depending upon what we heard from our teachers. So first of all, because God is not there in front of you. If you see him in front of you, it's very easy to understand. Oh, here is God. How are you, God? But since God is not there in front of you, how do you know God exists? How do you know God is the creator? You have to hear from somebody. The knowledge of God is revealed knowledge. There is many ways of gaining knowledge. One way of gaining knowledge is open your eyes and ears and look at the world and gather information from the world. So one way of gaining knowledge is through the senses. Another way of gaining knowledge is by thinking. Logical, rational thinking, you can gain knowledge. But as far as the divine God is concerned, these are not the ways of gaining knowledge. That's why some people say, "I don't believe in God." Because you are only operating the sense organs and your rational faculty. By rational faculty, you cannot gain knowledge of God. Nor can you know God by opening your eyes and using your sense organs. Because God is something beyond and subtle. And hence, how do we know about the existence of God? The only way to know God is revelation, revealed knowledge. And hence, the Upanishads and all the scriptures, whatever may be the nature of the scripture, whether it's the Western scripture or the Eastern scripture, these are all revealed knowledge. There is a revelation, and through that, knowledge comes. And if you don't understand the meaning of revelation, then there is no way of having faith in God. So the scripture, the Upanishad, is called Shruti, what is heard. Moses heard, or the rishis heard in their seat of meditation. Something spoke to them, some power spoke to them. They immediately scribbled down whatever they got. And you heard in the Bible, Moses heard a voice. There's a burning bush, and Moses was called, "Come here." I'm talking about a burning bush, not President Bush. So Moses was called, "Come here." And then he revealed the wisdom. Don't lie, don't kill, don't do this, don't do that, etc. So those kind of wisdom about God, it has to be revealed. So since it's a revealed wisdom, an Indian wisdom tradition, we call it Shruti, what is heard, not Smriti, not what is remembered, what is straight heard. So there are three ways of gaining knowledge. One is using the sense organs, second is using a rational faculty, and the third is using your mind in a meditative disposition, you get revelation. And very few people are blessed with such revelations, and they note down those revelations and teach humanity They are called the rishis or the prophets of the world. So first to know about God, to inspire devotion, you must listen to the glory of God. And when you listen about God, what are you listening about God? Let's say God is a creator. That is a fundamental definition. He is the creator of the world. You and I did not create the world, I hope. It is not you and I who created. Somebody created the world. The world being a very organized entity, there is a creator. So God is the creator of the world. We have to hear it. We have to hear it from the tradition, from the masters, from the parents. Then alone we understand it. By simply sitting and thinking or having a discussion, you don't understand it. Or nowadays, they take a microphone, go around. They go to a barber. Do you believe in God? No. Go to a doctor. Do you believe in God? I have not yet thought about that. Do you believe in God? So finally, in the newspaper, God exists, because 51% of people believe in the existence of God. That's a ridiculous way of proving the existence of God. That's not the way to prove the existence of God. The existence of God can be proved only in a very contemplative state of mind. You get intimations and revelations, and when it is confirmed by the revelations of other people, that's how we understand God exists. So God is the creator. And the word for God in Sanskrit is Ishwaraha or Brahma. God is a Western word. We use the word Ishwaraha or Brahma. So he is the creator and he is the sustainer. And he is the one who destroys the world when the life of the world is over. Because the world also has got a life. Just as your house has got a life, the bridge has got a life, your body has got a life. When the life is over, the body disintegrates. So God creates, so maintains, and when the life is over, he dismantles the whole thing. And he rests for a while. And when the rest is over, again he creates. This is a beautiful way of putting it. This is a beautiful way of understanding the world. So there is an intelligent creator of the world. The world did not happen in a blue moon accidentally. It did not happen like that. Some people say world is an accident. It is such an organized, beautiful world. How can it be an accident? It is something like saying, let's say there is a heap of scrap material lying there, scrap of iron, maybe pieces of glass and then tire and everything in a huge heap. And then a helicopter flew over that heap and then disturbed the heap of scrap, and then out of that came a beautiful Opel car. Can you say that? It cannot happen like that. It cannot happen accidentally like that. There should be an intelligent principle behind it. Then alone this intelligent, well-organized world can appear. And hence we choose to believe. It's your choice. You can choose to believe the world came as an accident. And you also are an accident, you can believe that. And the greatest accident is that person who believes like that. And therefore he says, you can choose to believe, it's your choice, it's your sensitivity, it's your freedom. But if you are an intelligent person, sensitive person, we have to say, God is the creator. There is an intelligence. Whether it is, you may call it God, you may call it a person, but there is an intelligence. And there, that intelligence is most beautiful because he has created this beautiful world. And so that is the beginning of listening or devotion. That you have a faith, something transcending, in something which transcends the world. So he is the creator, the maintainer, and he is the destroyer. Because God is very creative. A creative person destroys what he has created or ignores what he has created. Once he creates, he leaves it for others to enjoy, and he walks ahead so that he can create further. You and I, if you write a miserable poem, you type it, print it, and frame it, and give to everybody free. Please read this poem. That is lack of creativity. A creative person, he creates, then he leaves behind, and he goes ahead so that he can create further. So God is always creative. And then he dismantles the world when the life is over. And again he starts his creation. This is the definition of divinity, of the transcendental intelligence, and one must be sensitive toward that transcendental intelligence, and that state of mind is called faith. One must have faith in the Lord. It's a sensitivity. It's a rational sensitivity, and you must have faith in the divinity. And this divine is, as we have seen yesterday, is karma dhyashaha and karma baladada. Because out of this divinity emerged the world. According to Indian wisdom tradition, God is both the material and the efficient cause of the world. He creates the world out of himself. This is a very, very profound statement. In the Western tradition, God says, let there be the world. And the world appears. And he has nothing to do with the world. And he sits in the comfort of the heaven and watching you and I suffering in the world. Whereas the Indian God is not that he just says, let there be the world. He says, let me become the world. It's not that let there be the world. Let me become the world. Bahusya praja ye ye di. He determined or he thought, let me become the world. So it is in that oceanic intelligence, a ripple of a thought arises, let me become the world. And that thought become three energies, three gunas. And those three energies became the five elements. And those five elements, from their various permutations and combinations, became the 14 logas and the human beings and all that there in the creation. So this creation is an extension of that intelligence. And hence, from the Indian standpoint, the world is intelligent. It is information. The world is full of information and intelligence. It is chidvilasam. It's an expression of pure intelligence. It is an expression of divinity. Maybe that's why in India we worship a cow as well as a snake. Because both are expressions of the same divinity. The piety in the eyes of the cow and the viciousness in the eyes of a snake, both are seen as expression of the same divinity. And therefore, we have this attitude of all-encompassing, all-embracing attitude. Everything is an expression of God. Because God became split into the huge, the manifold world. So if this is understood, that God is everywhere, in everything, and his body is the world, and he lives in everything, if this is understood, devotion becomes totally something totally different. Earlier we think of God, we lift our eyes and see he is sitting beyond the clouds. Now we close our eyes, isn't it? When you go to a temple, you may walk miles, get into a train, and miles, you go to Badrinath, Kedarnath, all the way from here, and you go to the temple, and you have to walk a lot of distance. And when you went near the temple, in front of the temple was closed. Then you stand there staring at the door of the temple. And suddenly the temple opens. When the temple opens, you take one look and then close your eyes, isn't it? Sir, why did you go all the way to close your eyes there? Why don't you do it here? So the idea is, I must realize God within me. It is only when you close your eyes, you can resonate with the world. Otherwise, you see only a portion of the world. So close your eyes, resonate, live in love with the world, because everything is an extension of God. So God is the creator, the maintainer, and he is the destroyer, and he is all compassionate God. He has got compassion for all of us, and he himself has become the world. Therefore, whatever you do is the doing of God. The devotee understands that. Whatever I'm doing, my hand is an extension of God. My eyes are an extension of God. My legs are an extension of God. Therefore, I am an expression of the divinity. I am pure intelligence spread out in many, congealed in this physical form. My physical form is congealed intelligence. And intelligence have taken a shape. That's me. God has taken a particular manifestation. That's me, that you understand. And therefore, God is all compassion. This one has to listen. Because this you cannot sit down and then just imagine. You have to listen about this from a competent person. And hence he says, Shravanam. The beginning of devotion is Shravanam. So devotion is totally different. The quality is totally different now, if you understand the divine in this fashion. So first is listening, Shravanam. Then Shravanam Kirtanam. After listening, then you start sharing that understanding with everybody. That is another quality of devotion. When you hear the glory of the Lord, and when you understand that God encompasses everything, and you immerse yourself in that divine understanding, you are like a drop of water in an ocean. You're like a fish in an ocean. You're like a strand in a piece of fabric. Like one strand in a piece of fabric. You're one leaf in a huge tree. You are one star in the firmament. You are one grain of sand in the seashore. You are one cell in the cosmic pulse. When you understand that, your understanding of God is totally different. I am part and parcel of divinity. So Shravanam, hear that. After hearing it, and it has to be heard again and again. After hearing it, you are feeling it. And then you have to share that idea with everybody. Now, whenever you meet anybody else, you see him as an extension of God. You are not seeing him as separate from God. He may be your worst enemy. He may be your worst enemy. And when you see him, your blood pressure used to go up. Even then, you see him as an expression of God. I remember a beautiful story said by Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. Ramakrishna, you know, is a great devotee. And once a great scholar, a Western scholar, came to him, Indian, but trained in Western scholarship. He came to him and sat in front of Ramakrishna. On those days, a lot of people, scholars, used to visit Ramakrishna just to see what is he, who is this madman, what is he doing? Just with that cynical attitude, they used to come. So he sat there and expounded his philosophy. He was an atheist. And he argued and argued and proved that there is no God. There is no God. He almost proved it. And Ramakrishna was hearing all this very patiently, very interestingly, hearing this. And then, at the end of it, after hearing all this, Ramakrishna just got up and prostrated to this person. He prostrated. When he prostrated, his disciple got really panicky. What's happening? He converted Ramakrishna Paramahamsa also. So they were all panicky, his disciples. And then when this man left, they surrounded Ramakrishna and asked, demanded an explanation for his action. Why did you prostrate to that person? And Ramakrishna said, I see the same God in him. In fact, I have renounced only the world. He has renounced even God. He must be a real, real saint. He must be a really great person. Because to renounce the world is very easy, but to renounce God is much more difficult. He must be a realized, really realized soul. So that's the kind of understanding when you know God. God speaks through an atheist. God speaks through atheist also. Everything is God's glory. You understand that. And hence, that's the meaning of Kirtanam. Shashavanam, Kirtanam. Spread the glory or talk about God. Especially when you do something great, when you do something wonderful and everybody is appreciating you. Oh, you are the greatest in the world. At that time, remember, it is God who is functioning through you. It is He who is functioning through you. That is called remembrance and propagating this idea. So, Shravanam, Kirtanam, glorifying God, Vishnoho, Smaranam, and remember Him all the time. And when you do this, all the time, you are remembering that you are a part of God and He is functioning through you. Remember all the time. And that remembrance is possible by saying it again and again to everybody. When somebody congratulates you, don't take that appreciation to yourself. Immediately remember God. I am only an instrument of that divinity. I am only a flute in the hands of God. Krishna, using the flute and blowing mellifluous music through the flute. Similarly, the Lord is functioning through me. So, Shravanam, Kirtanam Vishnoho, Smaranam, And even subliminally you are able to remember that you are always protected by the divine. You are an instrument of the divine. Even subliminally, unconsciously, we are able to remember. And hence smaranam, kirtanam Vishnoho, smaranam. Now you are able to remember your relationship with the God all the time. I would call this state as devotion, and you become a devotee at this point. Otherwise, we are only a votee. Occasionally we go to the temple, or Tirupati you go. There's a beautiful story that this person was very sick. When he became very sick, first when we fall sick, where do you go? You go to the allopathy doctor, isn't it? You go to the allopathy doctor. He gives you all kind of pills and tablets. And earlier you had a headache, now you have got a stomachache also, after eating all the pills. So when you find that allopathy doesn't work, then you go to homeopathy. A homeopathy people, they give you some small pellets, and you have to eat a whole lot of them. Sometimes you forget them. And homeopathy people also made a mess of your life. Then you thought of going to naturopathy. And naturopathy people, they don't allow you to eat. So you have become a skeleton, a ghost, and because you don't eat anything. And they think when you don't eat, then all the viruses will leave you and you may become better. But after naturopathy also didn't work. Finally, you decide to go to Tirupati, isn't it? So, Tirupati is the last resort. Why didn't you go there in the first place? Why didn't you take the name of the Lord in the first place? Padi means a system of cure. In English, Padi means a system of cure. And Tirupati means, Tiru means God. So God, the name of the Lord is the best system of cure. Remember His name all the time. As Shankara says, bhaja govindam, govindam bhaja. Mudhamade samprapte sannihide kale nahi nahi rachadi dukrinshkarane. This scholarship, this money, this wealth is not going to help you when you are in real trouble. Take the name of the Lord. So name of the Lord is the best medicine. It's the best chewing gum. Chew it again and again and again in your mouth. So he says, take to the Lord in the first place. Then you can go anywhere you want. But the first physician that you approach should be God. And the greatest illness of humankind is suffering, unhappiness, misery. So unhappiness is the illness. When you are a happy person, it doesn't matter whether the body is sick. It doesn't matter. You have that enormous energy all the time at your beck and call. Doesn't matter whether you are physically ill, you are financially suffering, doesn't matter, because you have access to that great energy. So he says, take the name of the Lord. Remember Him all the time. The first thing that you remember every moment is God's name. That I am protected. I am all the time protected by the Lord. That thought should nourish your mind all the time. And hence, Shravanam, Kirtanam Vishnoho, Smaranam, it has gone subliminally into your unconscious. Even in your sleep, you feel protected, isn't it? The problem with the modern human beings are, they don't feel protected. They feel lonely all the time. It's loneliness. That's our main problem. It is not only loneliness, it's a sense of alienation, purposelessness. That's our problem. So at this point, you feel so protected. And at that situation, so let us remember it. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnoho, Smaranam, and then Padasevanam. That's the next step. Padasevanam. Padasevana literal meaning is worshipping at the feet of the Lord. Pada means the feet. Seva means worship. Seva, do some service. Serving at the feet of the Lord. That's very difficult to understand. Because where is the Lord? So that I can wash His feet, that I can offer a flower at His feet, that I can prostrate at His feet. Where is the feet of the Lord? That's a big mystery. But it is said, Prahlada says, a devotee loves to wash the feet of the Lord, fall at the feet of the Lord, sing the glory of the Lord. But where is the feet of the Lord? To understand that, Generally what we do is go to a temple and pour some water at the feet of the idol and then clean the temple premises. And we feel that we are served at the feet of the Lord. But that is only a symbolic act. It is something like your father is sick, lying in the hospital, and you are doing some aradhi in front of his picture. That doesn't help. The father is sick there. Go there and do something for him. Or your father needs a glass of water, and you bring the water and put it in front of his picture. That doesn't help. So what do you mean by serving at the feet of the Lord? To understand that, you must go back to the Rig Veda. In the Rig Veda, there is a mantra called Purusha Sukta. In the Purusha Sukta, it is said, Pado Osya Vishwa Bhutani Tribadasya Amritam Divi. The Lord's feet is the world, the manifest world. The manifest world is the feet of the Lord. That is one quarter of the Lord, the feet. So to serve the Lord, at his feet means serve the world. The world is considered as his feet. To serve the world means to serve the poor, to serve your parents, to serve your gurus, to serve the deserving people, to plant a tree, that is serving the Lord. To nourish the animals, that is serving the Lord. To clean, to keep the environment clean, that is serving the Lord. Not polluting the Ganga and the rivers, that is serving the Lord. So to serve the Lord means to see the Lord's feet as the entire manifested creation and do something worthwhile for the world. That's the meaning of serving the Lord. The Lord doesn't otherwise require your service because He is the one who has brought you into the world. So serving the Lord means serving the feet, the world. Serving the world means, and you cannot serve the whole world. You cannot serve. In tsunami, 150,000 people died. You cannot serve all of them. Do something for them. To serve the world means to serve your immediate neighborhood. To begin with your parents. I was told there is a new legislation which is going to come. But not serving the parents are illegal. If you don't serve your old parents, you will be put in jail. A new law is coming. And that is in tune with the Indian tradition. To serve the Lord means to serve your parents, to serve your gurus, to serve the old people, to serve the sick, to serve the animals, and plant trees, etc., etc. So, serving the Lord means, the feet of the Lord means serving the world. And thus you can purify your mind, and you can graduate into the next stage of devotion. So first is listening about the glory of the Lord. Second is sharing that information with everybody. Third is subliminally remembering the God all the time. So you feel always protected all the time. You don't feel lonely at all. Third is from that confidence, you serve the world without expecting anything in return. And as a result of that, when you serve the world, it becomes archana. Archana means worship of God. So to worship God means to serve the world. That's the meaning of worshipping God. This idea is forgotten by the modern people. They worship the God means they just go to the temple, do something there, put some money there and come back. Even putting that money there is a selfish motive. I have taken a lottery ticket, Lord. So I am giving you 10 rupees. I must get 50 lakhs. That's a selfish motive there. Anyway, at least you remember God even on that pretext. That's fine. At least you are remembering God. It's a good deed. So, after serving the world, purify your mind. And then that becomes worship. Your whole life becomes an act of worship. Celebration all the time. Your life becomes a celebration, an utsava. And as a result of that, on continuing, so shravanam, kirtanam visnoho, smaranam, padasevanam, archanam. And with that attitude, vandanam. Vandana means salutation. You salute the Lord all the time. You prostrate in front of the Lord all the time. What do you mean by that? Saluting the Lord. Saluting the Lord means, when do you, those people who are in the army, they know the meaning of salutation. When your boss is on the phone, and you have to say all the time, yes sir, Yes, sir, isn't it? And the boss says, you are an idiot. Yes, sir. That also you have to say yes. Because you accept anything that comes from the boss in the army. Similarly, to salute the Lord means accept whatever he gives you. And how do you know what is his choice? Whatever happens in your life which you cannot change is Lord's will. That's the definition of Lord's will. How do I know what is the will of Lord for me? If my creator, what is his wish for me? How do I know? Whatever you can change by your effort, try to change it. Whatever you cannot change, accept it as Lord's will. Whatever you cannot cure, endure. Haven't you heard that? Whatever you cannot do anything, endure it. I am reminded of a famous prayer by Saint Francis of Assisi. He says, God, give me the strength to change whatever I can. Give me the strength to change whatever I can. Give me also the strength to accept whatever I cannot change, and the wisdom to distinguish between these two. What I can change, I must make an effort to change. Whatever I cannot change, I must have the strength, inner stamina and strength to accept it, and also the wisdom to know the difference between these two. So there is something in your life which you cannot change. For example, your height. Can you change your height? Nowadays everybody wants to be 6 footer. And you may wear a high-heeled shoe, but that affects your backbone, that's all. After using it for 15 years, then you get a very bad back. So therefore, that's not the solution. So whatever I am, which I cannot change, I must have the inner strength to accept. That is called vandanam, saluting the Lord. So when I say salute the Lord, it does not mean you salute literally. It means whatever comes in your life, which you cannot change by your personal effort, I accept it gracefully. That graceful acceptance is called saluting the Lord. Now, you are fully prepared for enjoying the nectar of devotion. By these services, courtesies to the Lord, you are fully prepared. Now you come to a state of dasya. Dasya means you will become a servant of the cosmic intelligence. You become a part of the cosmic intelligence, you accept it. So for dasya, the famous example is Hanumanji. Hanuman is the example of a servant manager. Nowadays I hear the word a lot, servant manager. Who is a servant manager? The highest ideal of management in the modern world. Servant. Who is a servant manager? Who is firm as far as principles are concerned and is very soft when his selfish interests are concerned. He is very soft. He can compromise. But when principles are concerned, he is very, very firm. A servant manager. So here he says, you come become a servant of the divine will, the divine purpose. A person through whom the divine purpose functions. Like Hanumanji. Hanuman's story you all know. Hanuman was an unemployed minister of an unemployed king. He was sitting on Rishi Mukachala not to do anything. There is nothing to do. Because his Wali was, the Sugriva was thrown out by Wali, and he is sitting on the Rishi Mukachala, and Hanuman happened to be a loyal minister. He did not desert Sugriva when he lost his kingdom. So both of them, only two people sitting there. And years and hours doing nothing. Nothing to govern, nothing to do. And Wali, Sugriva was a drunkard also. So he must be spending his time in drinking. And Hanumanji must be bringing glasses of drinks. That's all what he has to do. There's nothing to do. It was a boring life there. And such an intelligent man, life was boring under Shimugajala. There was nothing to do. And he got a wrong master to serve. And Hanuman was spending his time maybe playing cards occasionally. I used to wonder, what were they doing? Maybe playing cards, maybe watching a little bit of listening to music. What else can they do? And one day, Hanuman sees Rama and Lakshmana. When he saw Rama and Lakshmana, something happens in Hanuman's psyche. Some great stir happens in his psyche, and he runs towards them, carries them on his shoulders, and brings them to Sugriva. And thereafter, Hanumanji's life is totally different, isn't it? And he discovered his destiny, his mission, his master. Because Hanumanji was an extremely capable person, a highly skilled person. But he had no mission in life. Because when skill yoked with the mission and purpose, then alone you become a highly powerful person. So Hanumanji's skill was yoked with Rama's purpose and mission. And thereafter, Hanuman never looked back. Nothing is impossible for him. He is ready to do anything. All his powers blossomed and bloomed thereafter. He became a servant of the Lord. This is a message for us also. Don't serve any earthly masters. Serve only the divine, only the greatest of purposes. Thereafter, Hanumanji, you know the story. Hanuman had to jump across to Lanka, and nobody else could do that. He was ready to do that. And when Rama and Lakshmana became unconscious in the war in Lanka, it was Hanuman who was commissioned to go to North India. That was the month of December. And they had to immediately go. And night, the information came at night. The same night he has to fly to Lanka, the Himalayas. And the South Indian going to Himalaya, you know the difficulties. Because they are not used to this cold. They don't have any warm clothing. Because in South India, we don't have any warm clothing. And you cannot tailor it. At that time, there was not many shops also. So he had to go just with this cotton suit. He has to go, he has to fly. But Hanuman was ready. Hey Ram, he took off. He went there. But poor thing, after all, some monkey nature is there. He forgot to take the script. The prescription was forgotten. So when he went there, he looked for the prescription. Where is it? And he didn't have any shirt, so he couldn't put it in his pocket also. So he looked for the prescription, it was not there. Then Hanuman could have thought, anyway, I forgot the prescription, let me go back. No, he wouldn't go back, because he will not go back without fulfilling his mission. That is his devotion, his commitment. So he lifted the whole mountain, it seems. He lifted the whole mountain and flew back. That's the kind of enthusiasm and inspiration when skills are yoked with the mission and purpose. That also a higher mission in life. And thereafter, nothing was impossible for, and he never said no to anything. Everything he says, yes. The positive attitude. Why the positive attitude? Because great energy is welling up in you. That's why the positive attitude. If you don't have the energy, you cannot say that. You feel bored. But once you are that energy, you will never say no. So it is not a contrived emotion. It's a natural emotion. When you have so much energy, you are ready to do anything. That's the secret of Hanuman's utsaha. And from utsaha come utsava. Utsava means, ut means upward. Sava means flow, or the flowing upward, moving upwards all the time. So whether it's utsaham or utsava, whatever word he used, Hanumanji had this great energy, being a servant of God. And from there, servant attitude, you become dasyam, sakhyam. You become a partner with God. That's Sugriva's attitude. So Sugriva and Rama got into a partnership. Rama said, you do my work, I will do your work. It's very interesting. Why should Rama take the help of Sugriva? Rama can just shoot an arrow and the arrow will go to Lanka, lift Sita and come back. Because his arrow had that power. They're like a modern intercontinental ballistic missiles. It will carry the inventory, drop the destination and come back to the base. Similarly, Rama had the arrows. Can go there, find out Sita, because it has got such precision, electronic visions, and bring Sita harmlessly and to destination. Rama could have done that. He didn't do that. He wanted Sugriva to have the joy of partnering with Rama. That is the greatness of glorious great leaders. They let others do things and let others take the credit. Though they can do that, they sit back like an emergency light. They come up only when there is danger. Otherwise, they allow others. They want to make others great leaders. Look at Rama, from the monkeys, he made great leaders. Hanuman, Nala, Nila, Sugriva, great, great leaders were made out of these monkeys. Rama did not say, what will I do with these monkeys? What will I do? That's what a great worksman never complains about his people or about the tools. Even a blade of grass is a powerful weapon in his hand. So Rama said, Sugriva, you do my work, I will do your work. So a partnership, your effort, your individual effort, when it is dovetailed with the divine mission, thereafter nothing is impossible for you. The word impossible never enters into your dictionary. So that's the meaning of partnership. And from partnership, you graduate into Atma Nivedanam. There is hardly any distinction between you and the Lord. Become like gopis and Krishna. There is always constant dance between you and the Lord. Or Arjuna and Krishna. Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna. Yatra Partho Dhanurdharaha. Tatra Shrir Vijayor Bhudihi. Dhruva Nidir Madir Mama. The Lord takes your hand and you put your hand on the shoulder of the Lord. And there is a constant dance all the way in your life. So life becomes an experience of divine dance. Rasa Leela. In Bhagavad, they talk about Rasa Leela. So Rasa Leela is God joining with the gopis in a moonlit night on the banks of the Jamuna and accompanied by music, and everybody is dancing. The whole world is in a entrancing dance. Similarly, you feel that experience that the Lord is always with you, behind your thoughts, behind your feelings. And that's the ultimate state of devotion, constant companionship with the divinity. So let me enumerate it. First is Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakhyam, Atmanivedanam. And for a devotee, it is all the time a dance. He is an intoxicated state. There is no desire, personal desire. He has overcome his egoistic walls. He has pulled down all the egoistic walls. And his consciousness embraces the whole world. He is in love with everything. Even a minuscule speck of matter mesmerizes him. And he is in trance all the time. Like Ramakrishna, when he sees a flight of geese, a flock of geese flying, he goes into trance. A flower blooming, he goes into trance. A trance means not that you close your eyes and sit still. Trance means that experience of enormous energy. Anything can bring that energy for you. That's the meaning of trance. Sometimes we think trance means you close your eyes and lie down unconscious. That's not trance. That's not trance. Trance is this experiencing great energy while you are interacting with the world. You are in that trance state. And in that state you are supremely efficient. Hanumanji was very efficient. Hanuman did not say, because I thought of Rama and I forgot everything. No, he doesn't say that. Sometimes we say, oh, I was cooking, but I thought of, I chanted a mantra while I was cooking and the cooking was spoiled, everything. You cannot say that. A devotee is a supremely efficient person. He is a very precise person. So that efficiency and the pursuit of excellence are all qualities of devotion. So Lord and you are an eternal embrace and dance. That's the final state of devotion. Thank you very much. And